The White House has spent the weekend trying to clean up President Trump's suggestion that perhaps putting disinfectants into the body could kill coronavirus, while experts in the administration, like Dr. Deborah Birx, have clarified that this dangerous theory is not a treatment at all. At least one state is already trying to deal with the enormous fallout. Here's the Maryland Republican Governor Larry Hogan earlier today.
We had hundreds of calls in our hotline here in Maryland about people asking about injecting or ingesting these disinfectants, which is hard to imagine that people thought that was serious, but people actually were thinking about this. Was this something you could do to protect yourself?
The suggestion came perhaps from the president himself. Joining us now, the infectious disease specialist at Johns Hopkins University, Dr. Amos Adalja, and president of the American Medical Association, Dr. Patrice Harris. Dr. Harris, clearly this kind of misinformation is extremely, extremely dangerous. How should public health officials right now minimize the confusion, disseminate the correct information in a critically important moment like this?
Well, Wolf, words do matter, and it's important in this public health crisis that we have the voices of physicians and scientists and public health officials out first. We need to make sure there is clear and consistent messaging on what to do and what not to do. So I know that over the last couple of days, and it's unfortunate that we are here, but public health officials and physicians are having to say that no one should ingest or inject these household cleaners. And so we just, as physicians, the medical community, need to continue to be out front and give clear, concise messages.
Yeah, and as I keep saying, Dr. Adalja, any one of these disinfectants, like Purell, for example, right here, read the warnings. Right on the warning, it always says for external use only. So you got to be really, really careful. Dr. Adalja, it's understandable that people may be desperate for ways to protect themselves. So what should they be doing to seek out what we could call credible, safe information?
They should be talking to their doctors. They should be looking at trusted sources of public health information, like their local public health agency, their state public health agency, the CDC, the NIH. There are lots of sources there. And unfortunately, people have a lot of faith in what the president says, and sometimes it's not going to be accurate. And you really need to look at health professionals and scientists to actually guide you through what to do, what's safe, what's not safe.
It's really important. And Dr. Harris, given a chance earlier today to provide very accurate, specific medical information on a really sensitive life or death issue like this, the White House coronavirus response coordinator, Dr. Birx, instead, listen to this, she defended the president. Watch this.
What should the American people know about disinfectants and the human body?
Well, first, that was a dialogue he was having between the DHS scientist and himself for information that he had received and he was discussing. We have made it clear, and when he turned to me, I made it clear, and he understood that it was not as a treatment. And I think that kind of dialogue will happen.
So what about that? Normally, Dr. Harris, a dialogue on a sensitive issue like this would happen between a leader, the president of the United States, and the experts, the advisors. That would happen behind closed doors, not in a public briefing with journalists and the whole world basically watching on television. But with the Trump White House, they often take place live in front of cameras, and that's pretty dangerous, right?
Well, I think what we should always focus on is listening to scientist. I agree with my colleague here that everyone is different and should always consult their own physician about the issues. You know, in an address I gave a couple of weeks ago now, based on or on behalf of the American Medical Association, we really focused on the need to make sure that our public health officials are able to speak to the American public without any political influence. This is not about politics. This is a public health crisis, and we need to make sure that public health leaders are on the forefront here and are speaking to our nation.
Dr. Adalja, this is a sensitive issue that has come up. I want to ask you about immunity. Yesterday, the World Health Organization issued a statement, and it said this: there is no evidence yet that people who have had COVID-19 will not get a second infection. That was a specific statement. But then the WHO decided it had no choice but to issue a clarification saying they do expect people to have what they call some level of protection after recovering. They issued a second statement to clarify that the first statement wasn't necessarily true. What about that? What do you make of that? These two apparently very different statements coming from the World Health Organization. What is the answer?
Well, the first statement was really accurate from a medical standpoint, but when you take that and try and translate that into everyday language, that gives the impression that you have no immunity. It just meant that there was no evidence yet. Obviously, we haven't looked at these people long enough to actually test and see, do they have immunity? Do you re-challenge them with the virus? Do they get exposed to the virus again and not get reinfected? We don't have that type of evidence, but we do know from other infectious diseases, including other coronavirus infections, that people do develop antibodies and people are resistant to infection for some period of time. We need to understand what that duration is, and are they completely resistant to reinfection, or do they just get silent infections like with other coronaviruses? All of these are important questions, but we do believe that once you recover for at least a period of several months, you probably are unable to be infected. But we desperately need to get all of this quantified so that we can actually turn this into actionable advice for people.
And to their credit, the World Health Organization did issue that clarification earlier today. Dr. Amish Adalja, thanks so much for joining us. Dr. Patrice Harris, thanks to you as well. We'll continue these conversations down the road.